Hi, this is COMP1010 at the University of Manitoba. I'm Dr. Celine LaTulip. Today I'm going to be talking to you more about arrays, how to create arrays with literal values, accessing data from arrays, putting data into arrays, and printing arrays. So literal array creation is a second way of creating a new array. And remember that a literal is a value that you type directly into a program, not one that is actually calculated. So int I equals 20, 20 is a literal. Float f equals 3.14, 3.14 here is a literal. In this one, final string question, what is your favorite color? The string, what is your favorite color, is the literal value. Here we have double d equals I times f. There's no literal in this statement. We're actually calculating the value that goes into d from other variables. So we can use literals to also create arrays. And it looks like this. In this case, we're creating an array of ints. We're calling it array of numbers. And instead of having the new int and square brackets, what we simply have is a set of values in curly brackets separated by commas. So these are all ints, 4, 17, etc. And they're all separated by commas. We have an opening curly bracket, a closing curly bracket, and our semicolon. So that's a way to create an array and put values into it in one step. And what's interesting is you'll note that there's no square brackets noting how many elements there are. So in this case, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There are 7 elements in here, but we haven't had to say int 7 in square brackets. And that's because when we create arrays this way and give it the values we want to put in the array, the compiler can actually count these and know that it needs to create an array with 7 slots. So here's another example. This is an array of floats called array of floats, and it's got a bunch of float values, again, separated by commas. Here's an array of chars, and this one is a bunch of characters, and we have to put in the single quotations to make sure that the compiler knows these are our chars, and they're separated by commas and surrounded by curly braces. So we typically don't need to use the new keyword, and there's a lot of different sort of ways to go about creating an array. So let's look here at 5 examples. Array V, we're saying, is an array of ints. This is declaring it. And then on the next line, we say V equals new int 4. So this is the way that we showed you in the last video to create an array that can hold 4 ints. It's separated into 2 steps. So that's one way. So you declare and create the array in 2 steps. Here's another version, int w. So this is w is a reference pointer to an array of ints. And again, here we're creating the actual array with 4 slots. And we're doing this declaration and creation all in one step. On this next line, we are doing literal creation, and we are actually putting in the new int. So this says x is a reference variable that can point to an array of integers. We're creating it with 4 integers. We're giving it those 4 integers to put into it. And we're saying, give us a new array, and it's going to be an integer type. We don't put the number in here because the number is implied by how many elements we pass in. So you can do this, although you can also, in this case, you could leave that off. So in this example, we're doing pretty much the same thing as here, but we're leaving it off. So here we have y can point to an int array, and here we're asking the compiler to create an int array for us with 4 values in it, and we're giving it the values to put in there. So this is the same as this one. We've just left off saying new int. It's just sort of implied. So that's valid. And then this last one, we're doing the 2-step version. So this time we're saying create a reference variable to an array called z. It can point to int arrays. And then on the next line, we're saying z equals new, and the open and closed square brackets with no number in them. And then we're passing in what values we want in there. Now, in this case where we're separating it out into 2 steps, we actually do need this value. And that's because if we just didn't have those there, we would be saying z equals, and we've got some open curly brace and closed curly brace. It looks like the start of a code block. And this, using literal array creation, this is the only other use of curly braces in Java and in processing other than to specify blocks of code. This clearly isn't a block of code, it's a set of values. So curly braces are used for two things, for array literal creation and for blocks of code. And in this case, that could be ambiguous. And so the new with the open and closed square bracket is required to say, no, this curly brace is about giving us some literal values for an array. Okay. So all of these expressions that we could put into an int creation have to be correct. And all of these literals have to be of the correct type. So these are all ints and these are all int values. So that's all fine. We can also do something like this, where we create an array of floats. We're calling it X and we're initializing it with these literals. And in this case here, we've got an int literal and we're passing it into an array of floats. And again, this is okay. And it's only because ints are a smaller type than floats. So here's just some examples of what you might do with this. So you might create an array of strings called month names, and you might actually put the values in here. So don't pay attention to these dots. Just know that that means we'd put all of the months in here. Same here, we might have an array of ints and the number of days in each month. We might have an array of strings with valid moves in a game and strings that define what those moves are. We might have an array of primes, of booleans, and then we're calling it prime, and then we're just setting this to whether or not the numbers are prime or not. And so the values in here are all going to be either true or false because it's an array of booleans. So if you want to print an array, this is something where it's actually made easier in processing than in Java. So if we took this example, we created an array, int data equals, and we've passed in five literals, and we call println, this will actually print this out for us. And similarly, if we pass in an array of words to println. So that is something you can't do in Java, but you can do in processing. So here's what it looks like in processing when we do this. You can see that the numbers got printed out. And when it was int, processing prints it out one per line, and it tells you what the index is. And for some reason, when you pass in an array of strings to processing, it just prints out the words one after another with a space in between them, which is kind of interesting. So this is nice that processing sort of helps you just print out the arrays and see what's in them. That's great for debugging. In Java, though, this wouldn't work. So if you try the same thing in Java, you have to use system.out.println instead of just processing's println. So if we change this, which we can do in processing, we can use the Java call system.out.println data, system.out.println words. What you'll see then is that, and we're doing both versions because we're doing processing's print and Java's print. So processing prints out the values, Java prints out the memory address of where that array is stored. And similarly here, we're doing processing's version of printing out the words, which prints out the values. But up here, we're doing Java's version, and it is printing out the memory address of where this array is stored on the heap. So you probably don't ever want to really use this. It could be occasionally useful for debugging or just to demonstrate what's actually happening. But most of the time, you're going to want to use processing's println function. So, okay. So once you have an array and it's got data in it, you might want to be able to get that data out. So imagine we have an array. It's called my data. It's holds ints. It's got 10 ints. And we put a bunch of data into it, then we can get stuff out. And so the things that we can get from an array are the length of the array. And in this case, you do it by saying mydata.length. So again, arrays are objects. And in this case, length is a data item. So by saying mydata.length, we can find out from the array how many slots or bins it has. Now, we can't set this. You can never change the length of an array once it's created, but we can find out how many slots there are. You can also get the elements of the array using my data, an opening square bracket, and some expression that generates an integer index, close bracket. So here's some examples. We might say int x equals my data of 3. So what's going to get assigned to the x variable here is whatever was in the fourth slot, because remember we index from 0. So whatever was in the fourth slot of the array will get copied out of the array and assigned into x. Here we create a variable int z and assign 2 to it, and then we can use that variable as an index. So in this case, int y is going to get assigned whatever is in the third slot. That should not say second because indexing from 0. The third slot of my data. And then on the last line, we're actually printing out. If we wanted to print out what's in the last slot in the my data array, we can pass in my data.length, which tells us how many slots there are, minus 1, which we want to do because we index from 0. So we pass that in. In this case, if the array has 10 slots, this is going to say what's in my data at slot 9, and it's going to print it out. So important to note the sort of constraints on the expression. Okay, so if you try to get stuff out of an array, you have to make sure that whatever you put inside these square brackets is going to be a positive integer that is smaller than the length of the array. So it can be a literal like this, it can be a variable, it can be a calculation. Doing any of those things is fine, but you have to make sure that it's going to give you an integer. So if whatever you put in here gives you a float or a string or a Boolean, then that's not going to make sense because those are not indices into the array. And you have to check the range, because any integer won't do. It's got to be a positive integer ranging from 0 up to the length minus 1. Otherwise, you'll get an execution error. And the error you'll get, which computer science programmers have been getting for years and years, is the array index out of bounds error. So imagine this is our array. We've got 100 slots in the array, indexed from 0 to 99. And we do a calculation that turns into 100. And we think, oh, awesome, that's great, because we've got 100 slots. And we come down here. Well, we're indexing from 0. We try to get what's in the 100th slot, and there's no memory there that has anything that we're allowed to access, and so we get the array index out of bounds error. So make sure that the expressions you put in those square brackets are going to evaluate to this range. It's really important. So you can use this kind of thing, these square brackets, to either get data out, as we've just seen, or actually to assign data to the array. So, and you can also use this type of thing anywhere you can use any other variable. So here's some examples. Imagine we created an array of floats, and it's called data, and it's got 10 floats in it. We've got some code here that maybe puts some numbers in here. We could here just say, oh, well, you know what? Now in the first slot of data, we actually want to put a random number that's based on the width of the canvas. So we can do this, random returns a float, and we can just assign it into that first slot. Whatever might have been in that first slot before will get overwritten by this statement. Here, we're going to create a float variable. We're going to call it second, and we're going to find out what's in slot indexed by 1 in the data, copy it out, and assign it to this variable second. Here we're doing something a little more advanced. We're saying put into the slot 7 in data 2 times whatever is in slot 0 in data. So we're going to go find out what's in slot 0 in data, multiply it by 2, and store that result in slot 7. And over here, we're doing this, which is some kind of calculation, and we're finding out whether or not this calculation is equal to 23.6. You know, so you can, this can, an expression like this, where we're getting a value out of some specific calculated index in the array, can be tested for equality and be part of like a Boolean expression in an if statement. So array access can be used in lots and lots of different places. All right, so how do we put data into arrays? We just saw one example, but here's some other examples. Imagine we want to create an array of three integers. We want to put the numbers 10, 40, and 5 into it. And we don't want to use the literal array creation. Well, in this case, we do int square brackets my array equals new int of 3, because we know we want to store three values. And then we simply assign it this way. My array of 0, which is the first slot, gets 10. My array of 1, which is the second slot, gets 40. My array of 2, which is the third slot, gets 5. And then we can print this out. So we could also do this where we're creating an array of strings and putting strings into it. Strings my array, again, 3 slots. And here we're putting hi there in the first slot, nice day in the second slot, and good night in the third slot. And if you print these out, you'll see that they look exactly as you would expect, like this. So you often don't do anything to an entire array at once. What you do more often than anything is iterate through the elements in an array and do something to each element. So what does that look like? We use a for loop typically, and we iterate from 0 up to myArray.length. But we've got a less than, so we're not going to actually try to iterate on myArray.length. We're only going to go just up to it. And i++, so that we can keep increasing i. And then inside this for loop, we'll use myArray of i to do something with the data in that slot. So this should look very similar to you because we've done this kind of looping through a string. So when we do it through a string, we do for int I equals 0, I is less than my string.length. In this case with strings, you needed to have these brackets here because the length item in a string is not a data item. It's actually a function that returns the length. And then we have the same iteration, and we would use my string.charAt of I. And here we're using a function with round brackets and passing in I as a parameter. With arrays, you always have to use the square brackets to get the item in the slot. That is the syntax. So here's an example of iterating through an array. So we have an array of integers. It's named scores. It's got some numbers in it, and we want to write code that would go through that whole array and for every element add 4. So here's our array, int scores. We're doing literal array creation here. We can print this out to see those numbers. And then we can iterate through for int I equals 0 to I scores.length, but less than, not less than or equal to, i++, scores of I gets assigned scores of I plus 4. So this says, go and get whatever's in this slot. So when I is 0, we're going to get 4, add 4 to it, and then store it back into that slot. So this is going to become 8. And the next time we come through here, I is going to be 1. And so now we're going to look at this element, and we're going to take the 8, add 4 to it, put it back in. So this is going to become 12, etc. And so if we look at what this looks like in processing, you'll see that first we have, when we first print it out, we get the original values, 4, 8, 2, 10, and 6. And after we run our for loop, we get 8, 12, 6, 14, and 10. So now hopefully you're starting to see the power of these arrays. You have a bunch of data, and by looping through the data one after another, you can make some big changes really fast and without a lot of code. All right, that's it. Thanks for watching.